Hello students, so good day. We'll begin with a new chapter for today. So we're going to look at chapter 4, that is e-contracts, e-transactions or e-commerce. It is similar to contract that is physically made. When the same contract is made electronically, it is e-contract. So we'll see what is the nature of e-contract, benefits of e-contract, various provisions under IT Act 2000, what is the meaning of digital signature and its features, what is the recognition of e-contracts, legal issues involved in e-contract. So, as I told you, it is the same contract but shifted into an electronic form. So, e-contract is electronic contract. It is a form of e-contract. It facilitates re-engineering. It is again an agreement. There are different types of e-contracts, and it is helpful in drafting and negotiating. So we can make whatever changes are required online, because it is all in an electronic format. So everything becomes extremely easy to be managed. Now, what are the benefits? Once you have an e-contract, you can have transactions all across the globe. You get access to global market. You can have these contracts with anybody in the world. Otherwise, if you are doing a written contract, then you need to be available physically for bringing a written contract into practice. But with an e-contract, you have access to anybody in the world. It is convenient. It is time saving for consumers, cost saving. A lot of cost is saved. You can have as many sales as possible. You can grow or increase your sales. You can access it 24/7. You can compare the prices between different products. You get larger options in as products. It's a totally new business model. So these are the benefits of doing e-commerce. You must be knowing of e-commerce. What is e-commerce? Websites like Amazon and Flipkart. So it's a global market. You can buy conveniently. You can. It's a saving money for businesses even because they don't have to open stores now. You can sell goods very easily. It's 24/7. You can compare prices. There are larger options for products. So it's a totally new business model of e-commerce. Various provisions under IT Act 2000. What are these provisions? Attribution of electronic records. So IT Act is the act which takes charge when an electronic contract comes into picture. It is regulated by IT Act 2000, and there are certain provisions like attribution of electronic records. There are certain ways, certain methods with which you can maintain electronic records. So in order to maintain electronic records, you have to follow the norms given by the IT Act 2000. Now, acknowledgement of receipt. So there is a form of acknowledgement, a stipulation by the originator, notice from originator. These are certain forms which have to be filled when you are doing any transaction online. So it's a purchase or sale, as we were talking about e-commerce. If you are making any transaction online, then you'll have to make arrangement for form of acknowledgement or even stipulation by the originator, notice from originator. All these things have to be taken care by. Time and place of dispatch and receipt of electronic record. So dispatch of record, time of receipt, place of receipt, case of different places of business. So all this information has to be mentioned in electronic form, which simply means that you need to keep an electronic record of all these activities. What is the time of dispatch, what time you are going to provide this goods to the market, what is the receipt of electronic record, how are you going to dispatch it, what is the time, what is the place. And case of different places of business where all this thing is going to happen. We'll not talk about digital signature, its features. See, digital signature is defined as authentication of any electronic record by subscriber by means of an electronic method or procedure in accordance with the provisions of section 3 of the IT Act 2000. So it's simply, if you want to give power to any document here in a written form, we need to sign that. Even if you have to submit your own identity documents, they ask you to self-attest it. Your signature is required. Similarly, for any electronic form documents, you require your signature. So your signature in digital form is called as digital signature. Okay, so what are the benefits or features of digital signature? It is assurance of authenticity. It ensures that it is authentic. It enables the verification very easy. Things become online and easy. You can't repudiate a digital signature. Once you have signed, you can't, say that I have not signed it. You cannot deny. It is attached along with the message, and it is legally binding. You come under the scanner of law. So digital signature is something that is very, very useful, and it is used in terms of electronic transactions. Now, how e-contracts are recognized in the market, or how people behave in terms of e-contracts. So again, the same pattern like how we do it in contracts, we have to place an offer. I have to give you an electronic offer that I want to sell my laptop to you for 5,000. So you will have to electronically accept it. There is going to be a consideration, some amount will be fixed. There is going to be a performance. I have to give you the laptop. So how you purchase anything from online, like Amazon or a Flipkart or a Snapdeal, whatever purchases you make online, that is exactly the example of e-contracts. So basically, offer, electronic acceptance, electronic consideration and performance. So you need to have a list of points. You need to have you have a advantage of withdrawal. You have a limited period for performance. You can reimburse the amount also. You can have provisions to protect your contracts. All these things are there. You also come into purview of liability and damages. Suppose you are an electronic seller, or if you are an electronic buyer, if you get damaged product, you can still fight a case. You can file a suit. It is as good as a regular contact, and the only thing is that it is digitally signed. The company, whichever is selling the goods to you, is going to sign it digitally. So e-contracts are very well recognized and used. Now, there are some legal issues involved in e-contracts. So we don't come to know what are the true intentions, because there is a chance of deception. You get phishing mails, spam mails, wrong people contacting and all that. It is possible only in the online arena. In the physical arena, these chances are little less, because we are seeing the product physically. When you buy product online, you are not sure whether how it is going to perform and all. So seeing is believing in terms of real life contracts. But when it comes to e-contracts, we cannot judge about the true intention. The offer and acceptance in e-contract, again, it is a big legal question mark. How was the offer given? So it is a bit difficult later on to find out whether the offer was genuine or not, whether it was false. All these questions come into picture. Entry in force of the acceptance in e-contracts. So when you accept, which kind of legal binding you come into, what activities you are forced to do, all these things legally are a big question mark for us. The signature is a problem, paperwork problem, because there's no documentation maintained usually. So there is a chance of a legal issue in terms of, if you're buying something electronically, it will be difficult for you to prove when did you do this transaction, do you have a paper of that or not. So again, in terms of proving it in front of law, you need the paperwork. Evidence effect of e-commerce documents, you can't show the evidence. You'll have to show the computer records also. When it comes to electronic transactions, they want to see your hard drive, pen drives. They would like to see the drives, the spaces where you have stored this information. So they'll check the proof of computer records. Admissibility of evidence in e-commerce. So you need to check whether the evidence that you are submitting in e-commerce, is it admissible in the court of law? Is it accepted? And submission of the originals. Usually we have soft copies, we have the online copies or e-copies. Are they relevant? Are they accepted? So there are some legal issues that we are going through in terms of e-contracts. So with this, we come to an end of this chapter. I'll quickly run through what we have seen so far. Is under e-contracts, we discussed what is the nature of e-contract, benefits of e-contract, various provisions under the IT Act 2000. Digital signature and its features, recognition of e-contracts, legal issues involved in e-contract. We saw what is the nature of e-contract, what does it mean. We saw the benefits of e-commerce, like what exactly are the benefits, which we are all aware of. We saw what kind of various provisions are there under the IT Act 2000. What is the main benefit of having a digital signature? Is e-contract recognized in the real world? And what are the legal issues involved in e-contracts? So now we go to the next chapter, that is Chapter 5, that is Consumer Protection Act 1986. So we'll be looking at the redressal machinery under Consumer Protection Act. What comes under redressal machinery? What is the district forum? What is the state commission? What is the national commission? Then we look at rights of consumers. We'll also look at all of these things in details. So it's a short chapter. It's not a detailed one. We'll quickly run through the important details, and we'll take it into step by step detailed manner. So the Consumer Protection Act is something which was established in the 1986, and it is basically to protect the consumer. So you must be aware of some advertisements going online or even on television. You must have seen, they talk about Jago Grahak Jago. So basically they are trying to protect consumers. So is there a method where we can protect consumer? Is what are the rights of consumers that we can talk about? What are different ways of handling issues related to consumers? This was what exactly we are going to discuss. So when we talk about redressal machinery, we are talking about how do we handle consumer complaints. That is the main point of explanation here. So see, you make a purchase. If you purchase the goods, it is highly possible that you get goods which are not in good condition, or you get defective goods, or you get goods which get damaged very easily, and you have some complaints regarding the company who has manufactured the product, and you wish to address those complaints to someone. So the complaints could be regarding the product, the complaints could be regarding the services, the complaint could be regarding anything. Usually when it comes to food kind of a product, so suppose if we purchased milk, and the date mentioned on the milk was, let's say, 5th of June, but we consumed it on the 4th of June and we still got food poisoning. Can we file a complaint against the milk company? We can do that. Now, how to do that, to what extent it is allowed, to what kind of permissions do we have, how we can take advantage of this situation, can we do that? All these things will be discussed under the Consumer Protection Act. So Consumer Protection Act is a very detailed act, and it talks about different avenues where we can register our complaints. So there are basically three major forums. That is, we have district forum, the other one is state commission, and the third one is national commission. So what is a district forum? So it's a court, it's a district court for consumers. It has three members. They make one person as a president, and one woman is there among the other two. The tenure of this whole president or the whole members team is 5 years, or age of 65. Salaries are given by the government. So if you have complaints for the value of goods up to 20 lakhs, if your transaction that you've had is up to 20 lakhs, you can go to district forum. They will look at your complaint and they will help you in filing the complaint and getting through out of this problem. Here only district level complaints are taken. And whenever you have the complaint, within 2 years you have to submit your complaint. That's how district forum works. Then we have something like state commission. So what happens in state commission is, again, it's a three-member team. One president and one woman is required. It is salary is paid by the state government. Either you work for 5 years or you should be age of 67. It's like a judge. It's a small court. Okay. The complaints for the value of goods have to be between 20 lakhs to 1 crore. If your goods or services fall between 20 lakhs to 1 crore, you need to go to state commission. Again, state level and district level complaints are entertained. Complaint to be filed within 2 years from the date of action. So if you have a problem, you can go to state commission if your complaint exceeds 20 lakhs. Then national commission. Now, Again, it's a 5-member team. There's one president, one woman among the other four. Payment is being carried out by central government. Either you should work for 5 years or should be age of 70. Complaints for value of goods above 1 crore. So anything above 1 crore, you can directly go to National Commission. All complaints, state level, district level, national level complaints can be filed. Within 2 years, you have to file the complaint. Now, in case you are not satisfied with the National Commission also, you can then appeal in the Supreme Court. So if you fail to get satisfaction in the lower courts like district court, then you can go to... if you fail to file a complaint, if you fail to get satisfaction at district level, you can go to state level, you can go to National Commission. If you are not satisfied at National Commission, you can go to the Supreme Court even for your final decision. So this is the whole procedure for consumer protection. These are certain steps that we follow. And then we talk about rights of consumers. So as a consumer, as a customer, what different rights do you have? And how can you take advantage? So some number one right is right to information. As a consumer, when you buy a product, you have the right to get the complete information about the product. It should be printed on the product material. It should be made available to you. Right to inspect and select products and services. You have the right to see what kind of a product it is. You can inspect, you can select the products and services by your hand. All this right is there. Right to safety. You have a right to receive safe products. You cannot receive harmful products or damaging products or life-threatening products. So you have a right to receive safe products. Right to get after-sales service and consumer education. You have the right to get the after-sales service. If goods have been sold to you, you can contact the company again for after-sales service. You have the right to get the complete education about consumers. Suppose there are goods for which you need to get educated, you have a right to get that also. Right to justice. If you have any complaints, you should get an opportunity to exercise some powers to get justice. Right to choose. You have a right to choose. You can choose as many products, as many options as possible. Right to seek redressal. If you want to complain, you have the right to do that. You have the right to know the availability of articles, whether the articles are available or not. All these are the rights of the consumer. So as a consumer, you must take advantage of all these rights. These come under the purview of consumers. Now, this is where we end Consumer Protection Act, and we'll talk about what we have covered. We have discussed what is a district forum, what covers under state commission, what is a national commission, and the rights of consumers. Now we'll go to the next chapter, that is intellectual property rights. In this, again, this is a small chapter. We'll quickly see what are the objectives of WIPO. What do you mean by patents and rights of patentee? What is copyright and its subject matter? What is trademark and rights of trademark holder? So we'll see objectives of WIPO. WIPO is World Intellectual Property Organization. This organization was created to do certain things. There were certain objectives of this organization, that is WIPO. The main objective of this organization was to promote the protection of intellectual property. Now, what is intellectual property? Any content that is getting created freshly comes under intellectual property. So to promote the protection of intellectual property, so they wanted to protect this property. So for example, I am talking, I'm giving out knowledge. This is an intellectual property. If you are writing a poetry, that is an intellectual property. So this organization was created to protect the brain related intellectual property. Anything that comes out of brain, music, poetry writing, story writing should be protected. To ensure the cooperation with the world, to improve access to wealth of technological information, to develop capacity to use information. So they brought a lot of information in place. They brought a lot of activities in place wherein we can access content globally to assist in identifying intellectual property assets. How to decide whether this is intellectual property or this is just copied. To establish contracts, how to build contracts. Now that I have written a story of a movie, I've written a story of a movie, how will I sell this story and what price to fix for this story? Okay, this helps us in establishing contracts to improve the protection of research results. So whatever research is done, you know, whatever research results are there, how to protect that research result. So World Intellectual Property Organization was the first step taken to protect intellectual properties. Then we'll talk about what is the meaning of patents and what is the rights of a patentee. See, you must be aware of patents. A patent is a set of exclusive rights granted by a state to an inventor or his assignee for a fixed period of time in exchange for a disclosure of an invention. So you must have seen that movie Three Idiots. They were talking about Aamir Khan having 400 patents of products. So they showed different products which he had innovated, and he got patented for that. So patent is a right. It's an exclusive right which is granted by the nation to an inventor for his whatever work he has done for a fixed period of time, and he will disclose what he has done in order to so that it can be further, you know, if someone wants to actually do that activity with his company, he will purchase that right of doing that activity. So as a patentee, now that you have purchased the patent, you own a patent, you own a thing which you have created, you can use it, you have a right to exploit it. I mean, you can use it the way you want. You can exercise it, you can transfer or surrender the patent, you can surrender it back to the government, you can transfer it to someone else's name. You can seal it, okay? I mean, before sealing it, you have the right whether you want to seal it or not. You can file a case against someone who has copied a similar patent. So patent is something which new technology, new innovation, something new that you have created, you have a right to protect it. You have a right to own it. It is a kind of an ownership that you have. So that is what a patent is all about. Now we talk about copyright. Now see, patent was something related to innovation, something related to new that we derive. But copyright is something different. Copyright is a statutory right to stop others copying or exploiting authors' works in various other ways without permission. So here you can very clearly see that they are talking about a word called as author. Okay, so it is very specifically told author. Author means someone has done some literary work, maybe written a story, written a poetry, written a book, sang a song, created music. It could be any art related work, literary work, written work, which can be copied easily. Anything that can be copied, any original work that can be copied, has the internal power to be copyrighted. So it's a statutory right. You have to apply for a copyright. So something, if you have written something very novel, something very new, something very innovative, you have written about it, you have created a process, you can make a copyright for that particular thing. So usually people copyright their websites, copyright their mobile applications. So the whole process is copyrighted. Step by step, it is protected by the law. So it's a statutory right. It will stop others from copying or exploiting the work of the author in various other ways without permission. So if you want to copy it, you have to mention. Suppose you like someone's story, you liked someone's work, someone's literary work, and you want to mention it in your own blog. You're writing a blog and you want to mention that thing. Okay, so you'll have to mention that, where did you pick this line up? When I was talking about Three Idiots, and I was very clearly telling that this situation is taken from the movie Three Idiots. So I'm giving that credit from where I got this information, from where I got this literary work or artwork. I have to give the credit. So that is what copyright does. Copyright protects people from copying their work. So subject matter of copyright, the original literary work or dramatic work, anyone has written a novel, or has written literature, has written drama, any musical work, any artistic work, any sound recording, any film someone has. So you see, someone has created a film. Imagine so much hard work has gone into creating a film. So, you know, it has to be protected. Now, you must be knowing, in India, we have a movie called Sholay. Now, this movie, you know, it was produced in the year 1975. It was the biggest blockbuster of the year 1975. It continued to be in the theaters for 50 weeks, which is, you know, close to a year it was there in theaters. 75 weeks also. So, in 1999, there was a company, a filmmaking company called as Pritish Nandi Communications. So Pritish Nandi Communications, they bought the copyrights of Sholay the movie. Okay. So copyrights usually expire after 25 years. So in like close to 1 year before, they purchased the rights, or maybe when the rights were expired, so they purchased the rights. Now Pritish Nandi Communications is the owner of the movie Sholay. That means now they can use the same story, or they can create stories around it. Now, what they are doing, what they are planning the remake of the movie Sholay. Okay, that is obvious. First, they will bring a remake of the movie. Then, they are launching cartoon movie of the same remake. Interesting. Then, they are making a sequel of the movie, which means, what happens next? What happens after Sholay? And then they are making the prequel of the movie. Where did Jai Veeru come from? And also, now, whatever they have invested in, okay, they have paid 100 crores for that. Will they not recover it? They will. Because now they have the rights to use that literary work in a very systematic manner. So what comes under copyright is anything that is original, anything related to drama, story, writing, novels, musical art, sound recording, film, anything that comes under copyright. Now we'll talk about trademark and rights of trademark holder. So a trademark is a distinctive sign or indicator used by an individual, business organization or other legal entity to identify that the products or services to consumers with which the trademark appears originate from a unique source and to distinguish its products or services from those of other entities. So any business organization, suppose I am running a business organization and I want to show that my products are genuine, my products are unique, my products are original and I have created my product, this is my way, I can put a trademark sign to it if I am the original producer of the good, and I can show that yes, I am the owner of this particular thing. So with the help of that trademark, I get access to the whole business world. It's a sign, it's just a symbol. Usually you'll see next to the products as TM. So it's an indicator or other legal identity to products or services. They tell that my products originate from a unique source and it is not like everywhere available. It's a very unique brand, it's a unique thing. What are the rights that I will have as a trademark holder? Others, I'll not allow others to use it. So if I put, let's say if I put ABC brand and I put TM there, no one else can use that brand. Brand name for the same category of products. Right to use, I get the authority to use that. Right to transfer, I get the right to transfer that also. Right to surrender, I also have the right to give it to someone. I can decide that okay, I don't want it anymore. Right to sue, I can file a case against someone who is trying to copy this trademark of mine. So I get these rights along with trademark ownership. Okay, so we are done with this topic for today, that is IPR, that is intellectual property rights. There are four things that we saw today, that is World Intellectual Property Organization. We learnt about patents and rights of patentee, copyright and its subject matter, trademark and rights of trademark holder. So what is a World International Intellectual Property Organization? What does it do? What are the objectives? We learnt about patents and rights of patentee. We learned about copyright and its subject matter. We discussed about the movie Sholay also here. So we discussed how Pritish Nandi Communication is going to use that to create more content. I mean, more advantages are going to be taken with the help of copyright. So again, then we looked at what is trademark and what are the rights of a trademark holder, and you know, how we can take advantage of having a trademark in a business. So with this, I'll end this lecture today. I'll continue with the next lecture the next time. Thank you so much. See you.